To Bible study number seven. I think it's seven or six. We're on chapter seven, although we only finished, no.
Six and a half.
Yeah, six and a half we got to last time. So as a matter of review, why don't we just go back and do chapter six? Because it was kind of a heavy chapter. When men began to increase in number on the earth and daughters were born to them, the sons of God saw that the daughters of men were beautiful, and they married any of them they chose. So, again, this is the ability of, we're assuming that these sons of God were actually fallen angels. That seems to be the best explanation if you go on through the Bible to try and explain where the giants came from. And if that is the case, that it illustrates the point where demonic powers can manifest in a human body, but this seems to be unique, and it would seem that if they did, that they would then have to live the lifetime of a human. They couldn't go back as demonic spirits. If that is a true interpretation, the Nephil, which the Hebrew word, which means bully or tyrant, were actually demonic spirits, it shows you the need and the value of the gift of revelation to find out what God is trying to say to us. So we need revelation to explain revelation. I can't just expect to get God's meaning from my intellect, although I use my intellect. In verse 3, then the Lord said, my spirit will not contend with man forever, for he is mortal. His days will be 120 years. So this of course says two things. One, man is limited. He's not going to be here forever. And of course, God had said he was going to die. And so that gives him a limited time to get right with God, because time is running out. He doesn't have forever. And on the other hand, we're not sure what God means. I will not contend with man forever. It also means that God is limited now into the amount of time he has to try and lead us into his kingdom. So both have their limitations, which are the result of the fall, and it's too bad. God isn't able to continue ministering to people as long as he perhaps would have. Verse 3 is the fifth prophecy that we've met in the book of Genesis, and it's a warning. Verse 3, then the Lord said, my spirit will not contend with man forever, for he is mortal. His days will be 120 years. So that should have been a warning to the people of that time. You know, we better really think about life and not just keep on going the way we're going, because time is going to run out. In verse 4, the Nephilim were on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God went into the daughters of men and had children by them. They were the heroes of old, men of renown. So it seems like I listed about eight or nine conditions about demonic spirits becoming people. One was, as I already suggested, I think it was a one-way street. Once you go that route, you're not coming back. Number two, you become human, you mean you have a lifespan, you're going to die. Number three, it was a unique level of evilness. And if you go to the New Testament, I think it's those special fallen angels that are now locked in a prison. Most fallen angels are either demons or else still available and still working for Satan. But this group had been locked up, and it seems like they committed a unique crime. This could be it. And in the New Testament, we read about a special prison. In Greek, it's called Tartarus. And when you get to the book of Revelation, at one point, an angel comes and unlocks the bottomless pit, and a bunch of demons come out and have the ability to torture mankind for 5 months. So it could be these spirits that got released at that time. The other point is that Satan doesn't have unlimited numbers to do this with. He's only got one third of all the angels that were in heaven, And he's got to divide up his forces as to how he's going to work in the future. And if this thing goes sour, he's going to lose a lot of them. So, because maybe he knew that condition, and he didn't put them all down that way. A sixth reason would be Satan's attempt to pollute the messianic line. If he could get demons involved with women, and it was the line the Messiah was going to come through, likely the Messiah wouldn't come then. He wouldn't come through a polluted bloodline. So, but that was his intention. That's what he would like to do. Another point is that this is probably how all the occult mysteries were brought to men, and they began getting knowledge and how to practice some of that. It seems like the focus of the giants was in the Canaan area. There's some evidence of them outside of that area a bit, but it seems like they were mainly focused, and they were sure a lot there when Israel went to take it over the line. A ninth point that I didn't mention is I think that this is probably where in mythology, especially Greek mythology, they have these stories of these giants and these superhuman beings. Part of it maybe came out of true historic events, which they then mythologized and turned into heroes and even deities in Greek mythology. And so some of that may have come from some of this. And of course, Satan would be glad of that because he wants to pollute religions with myth. And that's been one of the greatest attacks on Christianity was in the 1800s. German theologians said what they called demythologized the Gospels and said there were no real miracles. They were just stories told by Jesus' disciples to teach a lesson. And they took the supernatural out of the Bible. And of course, Satan was more than happy for them to do that. That's where liberal theology is today.
Still a lot yeah. going on there, yeah. The Jesus stories or something like
yeah.
that.
Mm-hmm. Verse 5, the Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. So here it's God exposing his heart, how this broke his heart from what he hoped would be a positive result, and now he's got a big problem. And so he himself comes to the conclusion that the only real solution is complete disinfection. I remember seeing a movie, it was on when they were dealing with, what's the name of that bad disease in Africa? Ebola. If you saw that movie on the Ebola that got to the United States, anyways, they first discovered it in an African town in Africa, and there was a lot of American mercenaries that were working to help somebody fight there, and the Americans found out about it, so they just sent a bomber in, and they bombed the village and killed their own soldiers and everybody in it because they were afraid Ebola would ever break out, that it could kill the universe. It's a very interesting movie if you ever get a chance to see it. Dustin Hoffman, yeah, was in that. in verse 7, so the Lord said, I will wipe mankind whom I have created from the face of the earth, men and animals, and creatures that move along the ground, the birds of the air, for I am grieved that I have made them. So that's his broken heart. And this is the sixth prophecy we meet in Genesis. It's the first one that he's prophesying that a flood is going to come or destruction is going to come. Who knows what would have happened if everybody had changed? Maybe the flood would not have happened when it happened. Because that's the point of prophecy. The prophecy isn't fortune telling. It's not fatalism. This is absolutely going to happen because I prophesy it. Part of the prophecy is, I hope you will wake up and not experience where this is going to go if you don't do anything about it. And so if the world had changed, had a different heart change, I don't think the flood would have come when the flood came. Verse 8, Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. So this is not favoritism. isn't God saying, oh, I like that guy Noah, so I'll just pick him and bless him. It's because Noah expressed faith and obedience that God blessed him and God favored him. And it's not like he could work for his salvation, but he certainly had to demonstrate his faith in God and in obedience to God if he expected his favor. Verse 9, this is the account of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, so this is why he was favored. This is why grace was easy to land on him and easy to do things through him. This is the account of Noah. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked with God. So he believed, he took action, he got good results, he kept practicing it. He had faith. And he must have heard God's way of dealing with sin, because obviously he was a sinner like everybody else. And we have to assume that God explained to him what you do with sin. And that was, you need to confess it, you need to repent of it, and you need to make a sacrifice. There is no forgiveness of sin without the shedding of blood. And so, like Abel, he brought the right sacrifice and he got the best results because he paid attention, found out what God wanted, and he did it. And he got blessed. God's favor came upon him. Along with that, I put a couple of notes. I think it doesn't say it, or it's sort of assumed in what God just said there about him, but there'd be two things there. There had to be character changes in Noah that were different from the people of his time. And also, there must have been a lifestyle adjustment in which he demonstrated being a follower of God. So it wasn't just intellectually he believed in God and then obediently followed the instructions, but there had to be character changes in him. There had to be lifestyle changes in his life that demonstrated that this was true in his heart. Verse 10 just reinforces his three sons. Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And again, it's interesting that the order is with Shem, who becomes the ancestor of the Jewish people. And so this is our first hint on which direction the Messiah is going to come through.
But he wasn't the oldest.
But no, he was the middle one.
Shem.
Yeah. So often in Scripture, humanly speaking, humans tend to give the eldest son the preeminence, and he gets the biggest inheritance. He is considered the family leader. He is the one they expect to carry on the family name. But often in the Bible, it's not the firstborn that does it. It's often someone else. For instance, of the 12 tribes, it was Judah through who the Messiah came. It wasn't Reuben. So
what Jewish tradition was that the firstborn did inherit?
Usually that was the one through which everything passed. But that was kind of just a legal thing. Didn't necessarily mean spiritually that it happened.
No.
Yeah, so. Verse 11. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight and was full of violence. Hey, how you doing there, young man?
Hey.
Welcome to the group.
Hey, John.
Pull up a chair. So I think you see two things here. Inwardly, inwardly, it talks about a sinful condition, but outwardly, it's talking about sinful actions. So I think the same was true with Noah. To receive God's blessing, there was inward change that resulted in outward actions. it's not exactly what I'm saying, but it is of that chapter. Verse 12 is interesting. It says, God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. I think this is going beyond God knowing from heaven. I think God actually came and inspected, because you find when he meets with Abraham to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, he actually comes and he's going to go down and look at the situation. Before he's going to take any action, he's going to actually investigate. So God doesn't make uninformed decisions. He knows what he's doing, and he goes out of his way to get the details and get the facts. So why were these people corrupt and violent? Because they thought there were more benefits to life following their way rather than God's way. And it's because they put a different set of values on what is important. So sex, murder, robbery, whatever, get by your muscle, whatever means possible. They just set up a whole new set of values to enjoy the life that they wanted to enjoy. And God hasn't given any written commandments, although he's given lots of commands so far. They're just not written down. But they obviously knew the difference between following God's standards and their own invented ways. And they chose a different way. So God said to Noah, I'm going to put an end to all people, for the earth is filled with violence because of them. I'm surely going to destroy both of them and the earth. Interesting. Now he's moved not only destroying the people, but he's also going to destroy the earth. Which, again, goes back to that concept that anything we do, good or bad, it's a corporate thing as well as a personal thing. I'm affecting the rest of the people in the community, and I'm actually affecting the earth on which I'm living. So verse 13 is the seventh prophecy that we meet in this so far in Genesis. And this prophecy initiates a spiritual principle that's going to go through the rest of the Bible. And that is where God says, I will disclose to my prophets what I'm going to do before I do them. And that's interesting that God wants to share his plans with his people. Part of it is to warn them so they don't get hit any sooner than they have to. But another sign of how God wants to engage us in his kingdom work. He wants us, and we're going to see this in a few minutes, how he really wants us to help him in his work of salvation. We can't accomplish salvation, but we can partner with him in bringing it about. And so this time he's going to destroy this earth part of it with water, but if you get to the book of Revelation, he's going to do the same thing, but with fire. He's not going to destroy the entire earth, he's just going to destroy the surface part of the earth. Verse 14, so he tells, gives Noah these instructions, so make yourself an ark of cypress wood, make rooms in it, and coat it with pitch inside and out. So you see a request, a command, we see faith, and eventually this whole thing is going to bring about salvation. In the Hebrew text, it's interesting here, pitch it with pitch. Two different concepts, pitch it with pitch. And the Hebrew word for pitch it is the same word as to anoint. Pitch it, cover it with pitch.
And
with tar, pitch. But the pitch it is not tar. It's a method, or it's about an activity that he's telling him to do. And it's the same Hebrew word that is used further on in Scripture for when you anoint something. And of course, it becomes a spiritual symbol of anointing something with the belief that the power or the presence of the Holy Spirit is going to come upon it and bless it. And so that's going to become an important symbol. Of course, you just can't go around anointing things and think they're, somehow that's going to change it. It has to meet the right requirements in order for the pitching to be of any value. So Noah had to build the boat according to specifications that God gave him, and he had to pitch it with tar, as God told him to. He even told him what kind of wood to make it out of. So he had to follow instructions for the real anointing to come upon it. Another point that comes out in this is, again, as I already mentioned, God taking Noah, as a fellow carpenter, a fellow worker in bringing salvation to those who were walking with him. And if Noah wanted to survive, he had to build that boat. There's no surviving, Noah, if you don't build the boat. I mean, you can go to, you'll die and go to heaven, but I am destroying this place. And so Noah had the choice. Noah didn't have to build the boat. He could have just died and said, oh, I'm so fed up with this mess, I'm not going to be bothered anymore. I don't know how many years it took to build that boat, but I can imagine it took a while.
Would he have died and gone to heaven if he didn't build the boat?
Well, there's a good question. Does that mean he lost his faith or gave up his faith? He certainly lost his obedience. I don't know if he lost his faith. There are lots of Christians out there who have supposedly faith but aren't too obedient. And at some point, they lose both, you know?
I didn't feel too favored when I was disobedient, I'll tell you that.
No, yeah, you've lost all your hope and all your confidence, and you probably lost your soul too. Until you got back to God. And then in verse 15, this is how you are to build it. The ark is to be 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, and 45 feet wide. Very specific in its dimensions. So this is not, as in some religions, some mythological magic carpet or some way of getting you out of trouble and something magical is going to happen to get you out of it. This is very specific directions on how this thing is to be built. And apparently modern engineers have checked the measurements and have recognized that that boat was doable. The boat was floatable.
Did they build it?
Oh, did they?
Yeah, in Kentucky.
Yeah.
Where was it? Somewhere. They have a whole theme park.
Okay.
Yeah. You're not going to show us a video or a slide of that?
Sorry, I'm not a PowerPoint guy.
He's
somebody bring that, please.
Good popsicle sticks and a glue.
Something that's not mentioned here, if you know anything about boats, what would be very important in this boat is, and it goes on, is I guess it's ballast.
Yeah.
So what is ballast? Ballast is weight, right?
Right.
And yeah. Where do you put your ballast?
In the stern.
In the bottom. And in the next verse, or was it that verse? Yeah. Make a roof for it and finish the ark within 18 inches of the top. Put a door in the side of the ark and make lower, middle, and upper decks. So what would you put on the lower deck?
Heavy stuff.
Heavy stuff. That's where the elephants are going to go.
Yeah.
Because you need ballast. When that sea gets rough out there, mm-hmm. You've got to have ballast to keep this thing from blowing over. And it's interesting, it doesn't tell us about ballast, but it does say they built the three decks. So they would put the heavy weights to the bottom.
I don't know if it describes the conditions during the flood, but we don't know whether it was actually like a hurricane storm.
Who knows?
Just bobbing up there, right?
Who knows? But now, it sounds like they built the roof the sides up to within 18 inches, and there was an 18-inch gap around the whole top for air. So there was an opening. Some people have tried to say that the whole thing was locked tight. I think they needed to breathe and needed fresh air. That probably means an 18-inch gap all the way around the top. If you lived in Indonesia, you had to have about a 10-inch gap around the whole outside of your outer wall, and you put mosquito netting there so the air could get in and the insects couldn't get in. But if you didn't do that, everything in your house would turn green with mold, especially in Java where we live. So you had to have constant airflow through that house to keep the mold from growing.
They're called jungle rot.
Yeah, jungle rot. Yes.
During the Second World War, that's...
Your blankets would turn into that. Yeah, your clothes would turn into that. Everything would just go green.
The clothing that you're wearing.
Verse 16, we talked about that. Verse 17, I am going to bring floodwaters on the earth to destroy all life under the heavens, every creature that has the breath of life in it. Everything on earth will perish. So here's our eighth prophecy. It's the third prophecy that a flood is coming. people, who was it? I think it's Jude, says that Noah was a preacher of righteousness. Noah is out there preaching prophecy. He's a prophet. He's saying, folks, I believe we're all headed for destruction unless you change your ways. And didn't get a very good response. And so...
Why are you building that boat? Because you guys...
And they said, you are crazy. You are crazy. And here is the first promise of a covenant. Although God has made a covenant already back in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. But here's the promise of another covenant coming up, which simply is a promise. If you fulfill these conditions, I will bless you. But you got to fulfill the conditions. The other thing about this, it's not in every case, but not all negative storms can be just attributed to Mother Nature. You hear that so much nowadays. Well, we can't control Mother Nature. Well, Jesus did. And I tried that a couple times when I first thought about what Jesus did, and maybe at times Christians are supposed to do that. And so I was at my with a couple of my brothers who had chicken farms, and on those chicken farms, if the power goes off, they have about 8 minutes, I think, to get there, get a generator going, get the fans going, or thousands of those chickens will suffocate in a hot summer heat. So they carried alarms with them, no matter where they were, that told them what the temperature inside the barn was. So we're in a restaurant one day and their alarm goes off. And just then a terrible storm hits. We're in London, blows branches down, all the lights are going out, traffic is all jammed. I'm gonna try this. I didn't tell my brothers, but I prayed under my breath, God, I take authority over this storm. I bind it in the name of Jesus. I command it not to hurt my brother's chickens. We drove through London through the storm. We got to Strathroy, just outside of London, and the sun was shining. You'd never know that anything had ever happened. I don't know whether the storm went there or not, but it's the first time I tried it. And every time a bad storm hits, I take authority over any negative forces in that storm that the enemy doesn't destroy my home. Because sometimes demonic powers get in storms and try to hurt us and damage us. We know that Jesus did that on... when he hit a storm. And you have to perhaps pray about it and use the gifts of the Spirit to discern whether this is something you should pray about, or whether it's worth praying about, or God wants you to pray about. And God can settle in your heart pretty quick. Yeah, this is worth praying over. Just renounce it. Stop it. I've even done that when I was out waxing the car and I saw black clouds coming. I said, Lord, I don't need rain right now. I would like to take authority over the rain and those clouds to hold off till I get this done. And it did. It didn't rain. According to your faith, it will be unto you. You may never want to go down that trail. I don't know. I found it works. Verse 18. If your life handle is in the balance, you might want to. But I will establish my covenant with you. So there he is. He promised the covenant. Now he's... I guess this is where he is actually promising it. I will establish my covenant with you. That is, I am offering to bless you if you keep on living my way. This is not a blank check. I am going to bless you no matter what. And of course, Noah wasn't bargaining with God. He had already been living a righteous life. But it's a good lesson to learn that if I want God's blessing, I want God's favor, I need to live God's way.
It's also not a prosperity gospel, is
it? No, it's not like even if you do live perfectly with God, you're going to become a millionaire, because Jesus died a poor man, and some of us faithful ones may also die poor men and have nothing to do with our spiritual condition. Verse 19. You are to bring into the ark two of all living creatures, male and female. Keep them alive with you. And verse 20, two of every kind of bird and every kind of animal and every kind of creature that moves along the ground will come to you and be kept alive. So two points I made there. The one is the natural, the other is the supernatural. So Noah, you get two of every kind of animal and bring them into the ark. But how do you go out and bring two lions into the ark? So the text goes on and God says, I will bring them to you. So somehow it's like migration. God put it into the heart of those wild animals and up they came. And yet Noah was involved in saying, okay, guys, right through here, into this door, into that pen. So you see God and Noah again working together, and you see the natural and the supernatural working together. And that is really what reality is. Most of the people in our world do not live in that reality. They live in a natural reality. They try to explain everything naturally. And you can go so far to explain things naturally, but that's not the whole picture. So it's not true reality. It's a false reality. I remember when I took historiography at university, that's the philosophy of history. Back in the 1800s, they had decided that no longer could they write history from any kind of a theological perspective because they didn't believe in the supernatural. And they believed that history nowadays can only be written from what you can see. Whatever you see, what you see is the facts, that's all you can write about. That's not true reality. True reality is, what might God be also saying through this event? If I never ask that question, I may never get that answer. But there are reasons. Not God doesn't always give us the reasons, but if I never ask the question, I will certainly never get the answer. And if there is an answer, like God said earlier, I want to share what I'm going to do with my prophets, and he doesn't giving you an answer, that's true reality. But we're living in a world where the supernatural is not part of reality. And so they're living on just the natural.
We're supposed to ask for wisdom, right? And knowledge is wisdom.
Mm-hmm. It's a gift.
We don't, like you're saying, if we don't ask for it.
That's right. Yeah, yeah. Then you got to step out and believe it and trust that God will give it to you. And
one other
will.
Thing, too, is it's also possible that these animals showed up in a very young stage, right? They didn't all have to be full grown.
Who knows, eh? Who knows?
I noticed one was male and one was female.
Yes, he's keeping them. He's keeping them separate. Yeah. Verse 21: You are to take every kind of food that is to be eaten and store it away as food for you and for them. That'd be a lot of food. Let's hope maybe they were young. A couple of things that could have happened there. One is that they could have experienced some measure of fasting in which they didn't eat as much as they normally did. The other thing is that maybe God changed the meat eaters, like he's going to do in the millennium, to being grass eaters, which he's going to do in the millennium. And maybe they just needed to put hay in, like, I don't know, what they fed the lions.
Do you remember when... oil last for a month or something like that.
Elisha the prophet.
Yeah, so he could have done a similar thing.
He could have made the food last longer.
The initial amount on there and he just...
Yeah, we had an experience of a can of candy lasting and lasting. And again, the confirmation of why Noah experienced God's favor. Noah did everything just as God commanded him. Chapter 7, the Lord then said to Noah, go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I have found you righteous in this generation. So, again, it's an offer, a request, and it's a command. I'm telling you to do this, Noah. But any one of Noah's families could have said, hey, I don't believe in this. I'm not going to do it. And could have backed out and... But the fact that they did all go in, I think, shows that they were probably all believers. But again, it's a mixture of belief, taking action, getting good results, and now it turns into faith, and they saw it. Now, it's interesting, we haven't got to the text yet, but God said, I want you to go in, but it's not going to rain for 7 days. You're going to really look stupid. You built this boat, put all the animals in, put all the food in, and then it doesn't rain for 7 days. So this is really testing your faith. Take with you seven of every kind of clean animal, a male and its mate, and two of every kind of unclean animal, a male and its mate. So again, we have the emphasis on the sex, the male and the female. But another concept here is, and I don't know, we haven't met it until now, that there are clean and unclean animals. So where did that come from? Obviously, God had to tell them what was clean and what was unclean. They would not know. But God had decided that some were and some weren't. So here is introducing the whole concept of right and wrong, holy and unholy, good and evil. And in some situations, only God can tell me what is the right or the wrong thing here. In some situations, only God can tell me what is the holy, what is the unholy. So the point, I think, is, and the fact it doesn't say where they found this out is, I need to go to God to find that out. In this situation, God, what are you saying to me? What do you want me to do? Is it your will for me to go on this trip? Is it your will for me to do this, to do that? And expect God's going to give me an answer in some way. Sometimes he doesn't give an answer. And sometimes he's just going to say, well, I'm just going to see if you and I are clicking along with the same thoughts here. Let's see what you do. You know, he sometimes does that. And but usually, if I'm asking for guidance, he will in some way give it to me.
And I, like on things that are categorical, right, we don't really need to ask in a lot of cases, right?
A lot of times we just know already, yeah.
A lot of times I found myself playing with that because I really want to do something.
Yes.
So can I do this, when I really already know that.
Yeah. Yeah. And especially if we read the Bible, the Bible's pretty good in giving us pretty good directions, and I can't expect to know God's will if I haven't read his word and where he's written his will. Yeah. And so I need to do that. Mm-hmm. Verses 2 to 3, take with you seven of every kind. We read that.
What's the seven? Seven pairs?
Yeah, of the clean and only two of the unclean.
So wasn't it just two of every kind of bird? So what are the seven pairs now?
The seven are the clean animals, what were considered clean. And also seven of every kind of bird. Oh, I'm sorry, of birds as well. May I feel? But another text, it says seven pairs of the clean and two pairs of the unclean.
So is this on top of the previous chapter where it said two of every kind of...
It's probably just a clarification of what has already been said, but if at some point else, it will say seven of the clean, seven pairs of the clean, two pair of the unclean. And the point I would think there is that God wants the clean to reproduce faster than the unclean because there's probably good reasons for them. They're probably...
What do they mean by clean and unclean?
Well, he designated what were clean. We don't know what were clean until we get to the law of Moses. It's not until we get the revelation given to Moses of what is clean and unclean. So a cattle beast is clean to eat, but a camel is not clean to eat because it has to have a split hoof and chewing its cud to be clean. But there's nothing the matter with camel meat. So again, it's not about camels and cattle. It's about, I want you to do just what I tell you to do because I'm telling you to do it. Because I want you to learn right from wrong. I want you to learn to ask me and trust that what I give you is the right thing to do, even if you can't always understand what I'm saying to you. So that's the main point of it. And so from Moses' time till Jesus' time, the Jewish people had to live in a clean and an unclean world. When Jesus came along, it all changed. All the ceremonial law, the clean and the unclean laws, came to an end. Because by that time, God hoped that his people had learned the lesson. You learn to check in with me to find out what is right and what is wrong for you to do in this situation. Because it might be right for Dan, but it's wrong for John. And both of you need to find that out. And the church has gone through periods in its history when the church has tried to tell its people everything that's right and wrong. It's an impossible task. The church cannot tell all of its people in every situation what is the right and the wrong thing to do. There are moral standards that never change, that are always right or wrong. That's one thing. But there's a million other decisions that you and I make that no pastor or church leader or denomination can say what is right or wrong. I need to, before God, figure that out. And that's a growing step of faith. And that's why Noah found favor, because he figured that out. He asked God, talked to God, and got it right. And God blessed him. And so that's what we have to do. Interesting also in that text is that we see, again, Noah having to take responsibility to join God in the salvation of what was going to carry on in the world. And that continues to be the point of being a believer, is that I join God in his redemptive program. In whatever way I can plug into that, that's what he's expecting. It's no different from Noah than this for us. It's just a different set of cards, shall we say, or whatever.
So there just seems like there's a difference. There's animals and creatures that crawl, and there's the other thing. And
there's birds, there's wild animals, and then there's cattle beasts.
And then, so the clean and unclean didn't fall in that category?
The clean, I think, fell in... I think the animals, just the main animals.
Well, where I was getting confused was, like, I always thought of, two by two. It's like, even we have the Noah's Ark book for Henry, and it's just like two lines and two whatever.
Yeah, no, so, like, they didn't get the details quick.
It's false.
Yeah.
But that's what they say in the previous chapter.
Because it says it at one point, yeah.
In the previous chapter, that's what they said, so.
Read on.
Can you assume that?
I stopped at six.
These animals he wasn't talking about them. These are different animals.
No, I think it's the same animal. I think it's referring to the same incident.
Or can't.
But it's more in more detail, whatever. It sounds like Noah and his family went into the ark. And it says they were to be there 7 days, and then it was going to rain. And then when the seventh day, it says it poured, it says that God put them in the ark. I thought they went in there 7 days ahead. So he's just expecting that we're going to kind of read between the lines and that, you know, kind of sort that out, guys, you know.
Well, to me, there's a difference between the regular animals, and it doesn't say which ones they are, obviously, but he must have told Noah which ones they were, or sent them to Noah, right? There were seven pairs of the clean animals, and only one pair of the unclean animals.
No, I think somewhere it says actually two. I don't know where I got that figure from, but I think somewhere it says two. But anyways, there's less. And
my text says, you shall take with you seven each of every clean animal, a male and his female. So that's seven pairs.
Does it say anything about the unclean? Which verse are you at?
Verse 7? 7-2. Yeah, they're talking about pairs. So four.
Yeah. Because verse 4, 7 days.
Point taken a male without the female.
In verse 3, it doesn't designate them like it does in another verse. Another verse, it designates wild beasts from domestic beasts. And then birds and creatures. So it doesn't, in all the text, doesn't clarify all of it. So you have to get all of the text to talk about it and then come to your decision.
There's a lot of sevens right there.
That's a very interesting,
sevens of seven and then 40.
Yes, and...
What are all those definitions?
Yeah, well, seven is a complete word. Have you ever heard of Bullinger?
So much. I mean, personally, I just, whatever it means to you,
But it's interesting.
I don't think it has any bearing on anything important.
But it's interesting that God sent the flood on the day of rest after 7 days, and he sent the flood. Did he just kind of sit back and exhale and everything blew apart? I don't know. Verse 5. And Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. He's really hanging in there. Like, he's going the whole 10 yards. build the boat, get in the boat, get the animals in the boat, collect the food, like, I don't know, maybe a year. I don't know, more than that, I would suspect, to build that boat with the technology he had. I don't know what kind of a saw he had for the beams. Maybe he just used an axe. There was no such thing as a saw. But Noah was 600 years old when the flood came on the earth. And Noah and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives entered the ark to escape the waters of the flood. Beside Joshua, I think we have enough of them, there's a handout. give me one of them before you give them all away. If I have one. Oh, I have one. It's okay. You can give them all away if you have to. If you look at Adam, who is at the top there, you see that he was, as we said last week, he was still alive when Lamech was born, who was the one just before Noah. So if you see Noah, Noah was born about 1056. Yeah, they put the date in there. And Adam lived up until the time of Lamech, when Lamech may have been 100 years old. So you have a very short span between Lamech and Noah. Lamech could talk to Adam. So he had the story straight, right from Adam down to Lamech, and Noah could talk to him. But then if you look at Noah and you go down to Abraham, you find that Abraham was alive when Noah was still alive. Abraham is the third from the bottom. He was born in 1948 BC. And Noah lived until 2006 BC. So Abraham could have had a chat with Noah. And Noah could have had a chat with Lamech, who had a chat with Adam. So you have maybe three major families. That's all the distance in carrying the truth forward all this time. Can you find Abraham near the bottom there? Very interesting. So you wonder if on Abraham's trek over to Canaan, did he stop somewhere along the way and have a little visit with Noah? Or did Noah move to Mesopotamia, where Abraham lived, and was that where he heard about God, the Jehovah?
Abraham could have sat on Noah's lap.
He could have sat on his lap and been blessed.
That'd be.
Yeah, who knows? Interesting that they're close. Their overlap is that much.
I never like did the math.
So I think we're down to verse 4. Seven days from now, I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and I will wipe from the face of the earth every living creature I have made. So this is the ninth prophecy. It's going to start in 7 days, but it's very specific, telling him how many days it's going to rain, how many nights it's going to rain. And here's one more warning. And I assume that Noah went out there and he preached it. But it doesn't seem like he got any response, any that we know of. And this is a preview of a picture of where sin ends up, is going to lead us. So what he's saying is, this is what has to happen. As a just God, I have to do something with this. I cannot just let it go on and on and on. I have to do something. And that should have sparked some kind of interest in people's hearts to realize that they need to get their hearts right with God. And so verse 5 says, and Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. In verse 6, Noah was 600 years old when the flood waters came on the earth. So really, in his lifespan, that was about his middle age. just like Jesus was about middle age for his time. So probably God gives us our heaviest physical work to do somewhere in our middle age period. And okay, so your middle age has moved up. I moved it a long way up to 75. I was still swinging them up till John rescued me. So God gives us labor according to our strength and according to our abilities. He must have realized that it was possible for Noah to build his boat. And so maybe he had to scour around, get some advice on how to put it together, but he did do it. The other thought I had during that, when you look at that chart, I wonder how long the ark survived on the mountain before it turned to dust.
Probably a long time.
So a lot of people probably would go on a little pilgrimage. Hey, we're going up to see Noah's old ark. It's up there on the mountain. Pack your lunch and where we're going to go. I don't know. But I think the evidence was there for a while. And it probably would be preserved better on a mountain side than down in the valley where the wood rot would set in a lot sooner. I don't know, but I think the evidence was around for quite a bit. And people still are looking for it.
Maybe they'll find it, or a piece of it.
Well, I think the people that needed to see it have seen it. And that's why we have the biblical text in our hands, is because there are people who experienced this, heard it, and said, this is the truth. And that's why it's got preserved so long, because enough people recognize the truth to preserve it. Verse 7, and Noah and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives entered the ark to escape the waters of the flood. Pairs of clean and unclean animals, of birds and of all creatures that move along the ground, male and female, came to Noah and entered the ark as God had commanded. And after the 7 days, the floodwaters came on the earth. So Noah and his family had to get in the boat. There's no salvation without getting in the boat. God was not going to pluck them out of there. He wasn't going to force them into that boat. It was a human choice. Now, it seems different with the animals. It's like migration instincts. They just came. But we're not animals. We have a free will. And Adam and Eve had a free will. And each in that family had to decide whether they're going in the boat or not. And yet we're going in 7 days before the rain actually started. So it's again the fact that belief must be put into action before it turns into faith.
And that's like a type of Christ, right? Like we have to be in Christ too.
And all of this is leading up to a whole picture of salvation. I think we had it in verse 1, if you take the position where the earth fell into sin, was put into chaos, and God brought salvation and restored it, I think that's one possible picture of it. Here is going to be the second picture of God providing salvation for those who will walk with him. And if you will, he will provide a way. But if you don't, it's not for you.
I've heard someone say basically that the whole Bible preaches Jesus from Genesis to Revelation.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's the plural pronoun of Elohim in Genesis chapter 1, verse 3 or something. That's, we are creating the world. So I think he's there. If you go to the Gospel of John, it begins with, in the beginning was the Word. In the beginning was the Word. And then it goes on in that chapter to explain who the Word is. The Word is Jesus. And it goes on to say that he brought the world into being. So yeah, it's there.
Do you think the people that weren't on the ark, do you think that anyone received salvation?
I think it's possible. There may be some, after the door got closed and the water was starting to rise, like God closed the door, if you go on in the text. Noah didn't even close the door. It says God shut the door. I assume that he sealed it. And for one reason is there was only enough food on board. It's got to last 150 days for what, at the time, only the believers were. So God made preparation for those who believed, and get in, guys, because I'm shutting the door. And he didn't want people trying to get in just out of desperation, not because of any different change in their faith in God. They just want to live. They obviously saw this is turning into a flood. This is a real survivor thing here, this boat. Let's get in.
Like, I'm looking at it, like, Lamech was probably still alive at the time of the flood, right? Like Noah's
yeah, life. Yeah, so...
So I'm just thinking, like, if he's somewhere, if he fell away, or if he's just a believer and he just got cut...
Doesn't sound like he is. In Dake's commentary, he believes that the only real believers were the family of possibly Adam and Eve, Abel, Enoch, and Noah. He says there were no other believers.
Hmm.
I don't know. Who knows? I know this, that when disaster strikes, sometimes the righteous die. God doesn't save everybody when the disaster strikes. And so I think there could be a case where people actually became believers 30 days after, as the water almost up the mountain. Maybe they made their choice, and I think they would make it. Dake thinks that in that text where it says that Jesus went to preach to the prisoners when he was put in the grave before he was resurrected, there's a text that says that he went to preach to those who were in prison, which is probably referring to Sheol in the Old Testament was a place where both the righteous went and the lost went. So Sheol had two categories, a place for the righteous and a place for the unrighteous. Because Jesus, in that parable of Lazarus, the rich man could see Lazarus cross the gulf. And so Dake would say that when Jesus was in the tomb, and it says he went to preach to those that were imprisoned, that he went and preached to some of those people who maybe have believed before that happened, and gave them an opportunity to really understand what they were believing. Maybe they just said, oh God, we don't know anything about you, but we are now choosing to believe in you before this water surrounds us. And that's all they knew. Who knows? I don't know. But there is that text where Jesus goes and preaches to somebody in a prison. And then he leads those captives, it says in Ephesians, he leads those believing captives that are in Sheol, that are in the side, that are believers, he leads them out of there into heaven.
He leads captivity.
He leads captivity captive. So the believers that have been held captive, he carries them into heaven. And so...
It's interesting, though, that I never saw that comparison. A lot of people's theology would say that you have, you know, you probably have a last chance. But here, the Lord shut them into the ark.
As far as physical.
Eliminating all the last chances.
Yeah, except if Noah was a preacher of righteousness, they heard the story. And maybe they never did anything until the water's up to the chin. And then they made their decision. Who knows? Maybe they shook their fist at God, which often happens. Everybody blames God for the disaster. And they never believed. Jesus, we thank you for being with us. We thank you for this study. We ask that you will help us to be Noahs in our time. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Can you hit the stop button, the red button? Stop.
The red. Little red dot that's blinking?
No.
The circle?
Yeah.